So we have already read the para, so we have to redo it. So I will read each sentence and see whether it's clear, and then we'll, if need to be discussed, we'll discuss it. Okay. The character of this inner crisis is therefore not a questioning of the thinker. Repeatedly, Sri Aurobindo goes on saying this, that it is not. Hello, good morning.
Bonjour, Rangada. Sorry.
Bonjour. You have to go to the chapter, The Human Disciple, and the character. We are going to read the character, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have already read it once, but we will.
Yes.
Acha, before we start, let me tell you that Archanadi had asked a question about Swabhava and Swadharma. Okay. I have started looking at it, and I started writing it also out, but it is such a huge subject. So when I have completed the task, I will discuss it in detail. I have started, but it's very, very, it is there in the Gita, it is there in the essays on the Gita, it goes right up to the Rig Veda, okay, the Purusha Sukta, there are all sorts of references. So we'll do that afterwards, so that we have a thorough understanding about the Swadharma, Swabhava, and the Swadharma is. So today we will sort of keep it pending, Swabhava and Swadharma. I'm reading the, the character of this inner crisis is therefore not the questioning of the thinker. Repeatedly, Sri Aurobindo is telling you that the Gita is a guide for ordinary people in the physical world. Okay. Actually, in the last chapter also, he will tell you that the Gita is a guide for everybody. Those who are a materialist, they will tell you, please have a dharma. Those who have a dharma, they will tell you, please don't be satisfied only with that, become a religious person. And to a religious person, they will tell you, don't be satisfied with religion, go to the spiritual level of consciousness. To the one who is already in a spiritual level of consciousness, the Gita says, do works in the physical world, become God's instrument. So it is a guide for everybody. And this is repeating, it is not a questioning of the thinker. It is the, from the lowest level, it is applicable to everybody. Okay. And what is this crisis? He is going to describe to you, it's a vital recoil. It is something which is terrible, and our vital is normally, some people have very strong vital and they can withstand even the harshest and the bloodiest of scenes. But very often we can't do that. We feel frightened. Okay, that is the reason why nowadays on TV they will warn you that some scenes are very, very violent. So be warned. And if you don't want to see, you can switch off. Otherwise, there can be it can be very disturbing. That's the reason. So the character of this inner crisis is therefore not a question of thinker, but it's a question of the vital being, the nervous being, which is recoiling at the prospect of killing so many of his own people. Killing other people is bad enough, but when you have to kill your own people, it is even worse. So that's what he's saying. It is not a recoil from the appearances of life and a turning of the eye inward in search of the truth of things, the real meaning of existence, and a solution or an escape from the dark riddle of the world. It is not so. Okay. What he is telling you is one who is a thinker. One who is a thinker, he recoils from the appearances of life and turning an eye inward, okay, the ascetic or the intent bhakta, okay, they turn inwards and see and search for the truth of things. Arjuna is not looking for the truth of things. He is only looking for a guidance in the physical world, how to handle this difficult problem. And the solution or an escape. So, a solution in the world or an escape. But this is not the problem of Arjuna. Okay, for Arjuna, it is not this. He is talking of the ascetic or those who want a spiritual life. But for Arjuna, it is the sensational, emotional and moral reward of the man hitherto satisfied with action and its current standards, and who finds himself cast by them into a hideous chaos where they are in violent conflict with each other and with themselves, and there is no moral standing ground left, nothing to lay hold of and walk by, no dharma. Okay, big sentence, and he explained to you. We'll go step by step. It is sensational. Sensation is the physical vital. It's your nerves. Okay, the nerves carry the sensations, and so your you know what happens now. If you see something very violent, your nerves start trembling. Okay, even when you get angry, I've seen many people when they get angry, they start trembling, or when they are disturbed, it's a sign of weakness in the nerves. Okay, so it's a sensational, but not only sensational, emotional also. Very highly disturbed is the emotional. Emotional is the vital part. Okay, the maybe you can say even the higher vital. Sensational is the physical vital. It is physical, emotional, and moral reserve. Moral is the beginning of the mind. Okay, so at all these levels, at the physical level, at the emotional level, and at a mental level, he is disturbed. He doesn't know what to do. Because until now, I have been told that I am a Kshatriya, and my duty is to do the right, protect the weak, and destroy the enemy. That's what. But now the enemy is not my enemy. They are my own people. So tremendous confusion comes in. The morality which is which he was used to is now being challenged in his own mind. Okay? That's what he's saying. This is a crisis of the man hitherto satisfied, hitherto earlier, satisfied with action and its current standards. This is a Kshatriya who finds himself cast by them into a hideous chaos. This hideous chaos is the enemy I have to kill is my own people. How can I do that? Where they are in violent conflict with each other and with themselves, and there is no moral ground left standing, nothing to lay hold of and walk by. No dharma. There is a very interesting note on the footnote on the dharma. What is dharma? Dharma, I am reading the footnote. Dharma means literally that which one lays hold of and which holds things together, the law, the norm, the rule of nature, action and life. So you have to understand dharma because it's a word which cannot be translated into English or other European languages. Dharma is the holding on to a standard at whatever level it be. Okay, there would be a standard for the materialist man. He has to be true to his own view of things. There is a standard for the moral man. There is a standard for the spiritual man. And there is also a standard for even higher than that. So, the dhri, the root of dharma is dhri, to hold, okay? To hold on to. We have, in even our Indian language, we have the word, na, dharo, to hold this. So, dhara, dhri, that's the word. So dharma is that which you hold on to, not physically, but morally, mentally, and spiritually. That is dharma. Many people say duty. It's not duty. Duty can be included in dharma, but it's not that. That for the soul of action in the mental being is the worst possible crisis. One who is confused at the moral level, that for the soul of action in the mental being is the worst possible crisis. Failure and overthrow. All your standards have been now kicked out. You don't know what to do. Very clear you were that what you had to do, your Kshatriya Dharma was very clear, but now that itself is being challenged. This is what happens in spiritual life. You, what you are used to, suddenly you have to face the what you are used to is not the truth anymore. You normally take life in a very, very easy manner and you don't bother too much about things until suddenly something happens which makes you think, my God, what is this? Okay. It can be a very violent thing or it can be a death in the family and things like that. You start questioning the values you are holding until now. Okay. I always quote one very interesting example. Okay, in that mother's embroidery department in the corner of the ashram building. Okay, there is a building now. Now there is an art gallery there. Okay, that house was bought by Dorisamy Iyengar. Dorisamy Iyengar was a very fine gentleman. He was a lawyer. And Sri Aurobindo, he was attracted to Sri Aurobindo. And he came and he bought one of the four houses of the ashram. Okay, the ashram main building is, I'm going a little out of the way because it's interesting information for you people. The ashram block was four houses, four blocks. The library house, then the rosary house which is there, then the place opposite the meditation place, and then the prosperity. So there were four houses, and the rosary house, okay, the one that is opposite the school building, that gate, that building was bought by Dorasamy Iyengar. And Dorasamy Iyengar, also the mother's embroidery department, that house also he bought. He had a several children. He had two sons and he had two daughters. One of the daughters had a very beautiful child, but that child got run over by a truck at the age of 10. Now, just place yourself in that situation and what happens to you? Suddenly you are faced with that. The most loving child that you had is suddenly gone. So you start wondering, what is the meaning of life? Why was 10 years of bliss given to me and now suddenly it is snatched away? What is the purpose of life? You start questioning. So this is what's happening to him, but not with death, but with the moral crisis. So he has to now, he is ready now to face it and go to a higher level than morality. Okay. Now, the revolt itself, I am reading the next. The revolt itself is the most elemental and simple possible. Okay. And he is describing what it is, sensationally, vitally, morally. So it is very, very simple. He is elemental, very easy, very fundamental, very easy. The lowest levels. The revolt itself is the most elemental and simple possible. Number one, sensationally, the elemental feeling of horror, pity, and disgust. Okay? This is the vital recoil. This can happen to everybody. I know of people who, their vital, when they see a person bleeding, okay, suppose there's an accident in their blood, they actually faint. I know one boy here in the ashram who was very, very intelligent, but he had to take his dog to the, he told me himself, he took his dog to the doctor, and when they cut for operating the dog and the blood came out, he fainted. So that is the elemental, that is the recoil of the vital being. He's very nervous, you can't see something so terrible. Okay. So sensational, elemental feeling of horror, pity, and disgust. Then at the vital level. This is the physical vital. Now the vital level, the loss of attraction and faith in the recognized and familiar objects of action and the aims of life. Vitally, the aim of life is to enjoy life, lead a good family, get wealth, and be happy. All that suddenly is challenged. How can I be vitally happy when I have to kill my own family? I have to take joy in my family, but now I have to kill my family. Impossible. That's it. Vital, loss of attraction and faith in the recognized familiar objects of action. Then emotionally, the higher vital. The recoil of the ordinary feelings of social man, affection, reverence, desire of a common happiness and satisfaction from a stern duty outraging them all. So he is talking of social man affection. That's common to all the families. But reverence. You have to reverence your parents and your grandparents. So there is Bhishma on the other side, na? So he has to give reverence to Bhishma. But now he is destined to kill him. So how can he be happy? Then finally, at the mental level, morally. Okay? The elementary sense of sin and hell and rejection of blood-stained enjoyments. Okay? Blood-stained enjoyments in quotes because he is quoting the Gita itself. How can I enjoy blood-stained enjoyments? Practically, okay, absolutely at the physical level, practically, the sense that the standards of action have led to a result which destroys the practical aims of action. In the physical world, what I have to do now is being challenged. But the whole upshot is that all-embracing inner bankruptcy, which Arjuna expresses when he says, that is whole conscious being, not the thought alone, but heart and vital desires and all are utterly bewildered and can find nowhere the dharma, nowhere any valid law of action. Yeah, you see, it's the chapter 1, Arjuna Uvacha. Drishtameva Swajanam Krishna Yuyutsam Yuyutsum Samupasitam Sidanti Mama Gatrani Mukham Cha Parishushiti. Sidanti Mama Gatrani. All my limbs are getting depressed and fallen, and my mouth has gone dry. Such is the Vepatusya Sharire. Even my whole body is trembling, and Roma Harsha Jayate. Even my hair is standing up on end. The description is very, very clear in the Gita. Okay, even the my hair is standing up on end because of the horrible deed I have to do. So finally, he says, I will not fight. How can I kill my own people? Swajanam Hantum Udyata. Those who are ready to kill, how can I kill them? Okay. But the whole upshot is that all-embracing inner bankruptcy, which Arjuna expresses, when he says that his whole conscious being, not the thought alone, but heart and vital desires and all, are utterly bewildered and can find nowhere the dharma, nowhere any law, any valid law of action. For this alone, he takes refuge as a disciple with Krishna. Give me, he practically asks, that which I have lost, a true law, a clear rule of action, a path by which I can again confidently walk. He does not ask for the secret of life or of the world, okay, the meaning and the purpose of it all, but for a dharma. He wants a standard of action, not the secret of life. So again and again, Srimadeva is stressing this. In other words, the importance of the Gita is absolutely applicable to the common man. So this is Srimadeva's constant reference. He's going on saying it is something not, it's not a spiritual document alone. It's a moral document. It's a practical action, how to work in the physical world. Okay, so that finishes the para. We can go to the next para. Yet it is precisely this secret. So who will read? Anyone can read. Archanadi, you will read?
Yes,
it is precisely.
Yes, it is precisely this secret for which he does not ask, or at least so much of the knowledge as is necessary to lead him into a higher life, to which the divine teacher intends to lead this disciple. For he means him to give up all dharmas except the one broad and vast rule of living consciously in the divine and acting from that consciousness. Therefore, after testing the completeness of his revolt from the ordinary standards of conduct, he proceeds to tell him much that has to do with the state of the soul. With the state of the soul, but nothing of any outward rule of action. He must be equal in soul, abandon the desire of the fruits of work, rise above his intellectual notion of sin and virtue, live and act in yoga with a mind in samadhi, firmly fixed, that is to say, in the divine alone. Arjuna is not satisfied. He wishes to know how to change to this state, how the change to this state will affect the outward action of the man, what result it will have on his speech, his movements, his state, what difference it will make in this acting, living human being. Krishna persists merely in enlarging upon the ideas he has already brought forward, on the soul state behind the action, not on the action itself. It is the fixed anchoring of the intelligence in a state of desireless equality that is the one thing needed. Arjuna breaks out impatiently, for here is no rule of conduct such as he sought, but rather, as it seems to him, the negation of all action. If thou holdest the intelligence to be greater than action, why then dost thou appoint me to an action terrible in its nature? Thou bewilderest my understanding with a mingled word. Speak one thing decisively by which I can attain to what is the best. It is always the pragmatic man who has no value for metaphysical thought or for the inner life, except when they help him to his one demand, a dharma, a law of life in the world, or if need be, of leaving the world. for that too is a decisive action which he can understand. But to live and act in the world, yet be above it, this is a mingled and confusing world, the sense of which he has no patience to grasp.
This whole paragraph again is insisting that the solution at the physical world has to be sought in the higher world. It cannot be sought as in this is itself a very interesting subject, and I will just briefly touch upon it. Okay, so there are so many problems in the physical world which cannot be solved at the mental level. Okay, it has to be solved in the spiritual level. That's exactly what he is asking for. What should I do? What should my body, mind, life and do in the physical world? But he's telling him, no, you have to change yourself psychologically. That's exactly what he does not want. Sri Krishna is telling him, you have to go to a psychological level to understand what to do in the physical world. So this is, and he's not satisfied. He says, you are telling me something which is not a physical action. So, and you are telling me to change my attitude, but how will that change my attitude? What will? Then I asked him, how does the man who is in Samadhi, how does he walk? How does he talk? How can I recognize that he is in higher? So practical, the Gita. Okay. So, this is also interesting. I just point out to you that there are so many problems in the physical world which we can't solve at our level. We have to go to a higher level to solve it. Just one or two problems mentioned. There is the question of euthanasia. Okay. When would you, euthanasia is mercy killing. I'm just giving one example. There are so many examples. Mercy killing. In other words, you are actually doing something bad. You are killing somebody. But you are doing it out of a good attitude. You want to relieve his suffering. Okay. It may be your own family members. It may be anybody else, your best friend. But you want to relieve his suffering. You are doing it with a good intention. Is it good or bad? This is a problem which simply cannot be solved at the mental level. No amount of laws will be able to solve the problem. But when you go to a spiritual level of consciousness, it is solvable. Okay. I'll give you one example, then you see. Okay, somebody wrote to mother about, my uncle is on his deathbed and he is dying. Please save him. Now, will mother save him? What will she do? She will look not at the body and the physical circumstances, but at a higher level, not at the physical level, but at a higher level. What is the higher level? His soul. She will see his soul and see whether the soul is willing to live or wanting to go. And if the soul is willing to live, she will cure the person with her power. Only a one who is at a spiritual level can do this. But if the soul says, I have had enough of my life, I have achieved all that had to be done and I have learnt enough, I want to leave now, okay, and go and take a next body, mother will let him lose his life. Mother will let him die. That also is an act. So this is a, I just given you one instance of euthanasia where the problems at one particular level cannot be solved by remaining at that same level. You have to go to a higher level. That's exactly what Sri Krishna is doing. Arjuna is asking for a solution at the physical level. But Arjuna is telling, Sri Krishna is telling him, not possible. You have to change your attitude. The solution to your problem is to change your attitude. You have to go to the silent mind. And from there, you will know what to do and what not to do. But he says, I don't want that. You are asking me, you are confusing me. I am asking for a physical action and you are telling me to change my psychological attitude. How can that be? Give me something more concrete. Okay. And Sri Ramda says, yet he goes on. Krishna goes on saying the other thing. Now we read the para. Yet it is precisely this secret for which he does not ask. Okay. He has to go to the next level. He is not asking for it. But that's the only solution. Go to a spiritual level. Or at least so much of the knowledge as is necessary to lead him into a higher life to which the divine teacher intends to lead this disciple. If you go to the next level of consciousness, you will be able to solve the problems here. Otherwise, you can't. For he means him to give up all the dharmas, okay, except the one broad and vast rule of living consciously in the divine and acting from that consciousness. Chapter 18, verse 66. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. All our actions in the physical world have motives, have ego and standards. We have standards. The physical man has standards. The moral man has standards. The spiritual man also has standards. But the ultimate reality of spiritual life is give up all standards and depend on the divine alone. Okay. That's what he's saying here. Okay. Chapter 18, the last chapter, 66, verse 66. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam braja. Aham tva sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami. I will deliver you from all sin. For he means him. He is Krishna, him means Arjuna. For Krishna means Arjuna to give up all dharmas except the one broad and vast rule of living consciously in the divine and acting from that consciousness. So, go to another level of consciousness.
But Rangada.
Yeah, tell me.
But Rangada, that can't be done in a minute or in a few hours, right?
Absolutely. That is why yoga is such a, it's a long journey, of course. Nobody is saying it, you do it in 1 minute.
No, but then Arjuna did it.
No, Arjuna was made to do it. After that, he again lost it and came back to the normal consciousness. Okay? Arjuna did not do it. Sri Krishna allowed him to go to the next level, see the reality and come back. In fact, even Yudhishthira also had to fall down to a certain level. Okay, so he was made to see. Okay, so therefore, after testing the completeness of his reward from the ordinary standards of conduct, he proceeds to tell him much that has to do with the state of the soul. Besides, you raise an interesting question, Pallavi, because they have to give the theory. Okay, so how can they give the theory if it is going to take 25,000 years? So he is telling him that once you go to that level, you can do this. It's a story, no? It's not a story, it's a symbolic thing. So he has to, in the story, he has to say that he has gone to the higher level and he is doing this. You have to see it in that way. Okay, so therefore, the testing the completeness of his reward from the ordinary standard of conduct, he proceeds to tell him much that has to do with the state of the soul, but nothing of any outward action, rule of action. He must be equal in soul, samatha, equal. Abandon the desire of the fruits of works. Okay. The karma phalam you have to give up. Okay. Rise above his intellectual notions of sin and virtue. Live and act in yoga with a mind in samadhi. Samadhi, okay, absolutely calm, quiet, firmly fixed, that is to say, in the divine alone. That's what it, okay, so that's what he is saying, that this is what you have to do. Then only you will get the solution. Live and act in yoga with a mind in samadhi, firmly fixed. Arjuna is not satisfied, obviously, because he's telling him to change his attitude. How can he do that? Change his consciousness. He wishes to know how the change to the state will affect the outward action of a man. You are telling me to change my, but if I change my action, how will it change me? How will the normal man be? Yeah. Sthita prajasya ka bhasha samadhi sasya keshava sthita dhi kim prabhasheta. Okay. Prabhashate, kimasit, vrajeta kim. How does he move? How does he sit? How does he speak? He wants to know. Okay. How do we know? Physically, there will be no reaction at all. But this is what he is asking. Okay. How to recognize the man who is in a higher consciousness? So, Arjuna is not satisfied. He wishes to know how the change to the state will affect the outward action of the man. What result it will have on his speech, his movements, his state. What difference it will make in his acting, living human being. Krishna persists merely in enlarging upon the ideas he has already brought forward on the soul state, not the physical body, not the mind, not the mind, not the vital, but the soul state behind the action, not on the action itself. no solution. Pallavi has raised an interesting question. No solution in the physical world to a difficult problem can be solved immediately. That's why evolution is so slow. Okay? It takes ages and ages. Okay? It is the fixed anchoring of the intelligence in a state of desireless equality. That is the one thing needed. Desirelessness. No desire at all. No desire, no ego. Equal. Arjuna breaks out impatiently. For here is no rule of conduct. I want a physical conduct such as he thought, but rather as it seems to him, the negation of all action. If you are asking me to be absolutely equal to everything, I am not going to act. If thou holdest the intelligence to be greater than action, you are asking me to psychologically change my action, but then action is far inferior to, then why are you asking me to fight? Okay. Why then dost thou appoint me to an action terrible in its nature? Thou bewilderest my understanding with a mingled word. Speak one thing decisively by which I can attain to what is the best. Vyamishrena Shreneva Vakyena Buddhim Mohayasi Me. You are confusing me with your mixed language. Tadekam Vada Nischitya Shreya Yam Apnuyam. That which I can understand, speak to me one clear word. Don't go on mixing up things. I am asking for physical action and you are giving me psychological action. So don't confuse me. That's what Arjuna is saying. He's not satisfied. So yes, what is it? If thou holdest the intelligence to be greater than action, why then dost thou appoint me to an action so terrible? Tell me to make my mind silent and become non-active, but you are asking me to fight. How? It's a contradiction. Thou bewilderest my understanding with a mingled word. Vyamishrena. Speak one thing decisively by which I can attain to that which is best. It is always the pragmatic man who has no value for metaphysical thought. Again, Shremri is insisting on that. Okay. For the inner life, except when they help him to his one demand, a dharma. He wants a law, law of life in the world. Or if need be, of leaving the world. I'm even ready to die, he said. But I have to find a solution to this. For that too is a decisive action which he can understand. But to live and act in the world, yet be above it, this is a mingled and confusing world, the sense of which he has no patience to grasp. He says, impossible for me to understand what it is. I am asking for a physical solution and you are giving me a spiritual solution. How is it compatible? Okay. We go to the next. It is so clear, the situation. Arjuna is a normal man. I told you, nowadays, even in many management schools, they teach all these things, how to calm, quiet, how to do action best in the physical world. Management is, after all, institutes of management, how to do physical action in the world, how to be successful. Okay. So naturally, you have to be calm and quiet. They stress. We go to the next para, the rest of Arjuna's questions.
Shall I read?
Yes, do that. The rest of Arjuna's questions.
The rest of Arjuna's questions and utterances proceed from the same temperament and character. When he is told that once the soul state is assured, there need be no apparent change in the action. He must act always by the law of his nature. Even if the act itself seem faulty and deficient compared with that of another law than his own, he is troubled. The nature. But what of this sense of sin in the action and which he is preoccupied? Is it not this very nature which drives men as if by force and even against their better will into sin and guilt? His practical intelligence is baffled by Krishna's assertion that it was he who in ancient times revealed in
Vivasavan, this yoga, since lost, which he is now again revealing to Arjuna. And by his demand for an explanation, he provokes the famous and oft quoted statement of avatarhood and its mundane purpose. He is again perplexed by the words in which Krishna continues to reconcile action and renunciation of action and asks once again for a decisive statement of that which is the best and highest, not this mingled word. When he realizes fully the nature of the yoga, which he is hidden to embrace, his pragmatic nature, accustomed to act from mental will and preference and desire, is appalled by its difficulty, and he asks, what is the end of the soul which attempts and fails? Whether it does not lose both his life of human activity and thought and emotion, which it has left behind, and the Brahmic consciousness to which it aspires, and falling from both, perish like a dissolving cloud.
Okay, so again, Arjuna is interested only in physical action, but the solution can be found only on the higher. So he goes on explaining the higher. So you come to the avatarhood, you come to the rebirth and reincarnation. All these things are naturally he has to explain. Okay, that's a reason. So all this in this particular, this earlier chapter only, the avatarhood as well as the rebirth. Rebirth also is discussed here. I go to each sentence. The rest of Arjuna's questions and utterances proceed from the same temperament and character. He wants a law of action in the physical world. When he is told that once the soul state is assured, there need be no apparent change in the action. That's an interesting thing. It's a very interesting question, and we'll discuss that briefly. So, the outer action does not change, but the inner attitude completely changes. You cannot recognize a spiritual man who, because he is not eating or not sleeping, not enjoying, nothing of the sort. He is doing everything. You will not recognize. But the one who can recognize him, his soul is calm, quiet, and absolutely without attachment and ego. The outer action does not matter at all. When he is told that once the soul state is assured, there need be no apparent change in the action. He must act always by the nature of his law. Okay? This is also the Swabhava. This is one of the quotations which I will have to discuss in the Swabhava. You have to act always by the law of his nature in chapter 2. Okay? It is very much there. Okay? Even if the act itself seems faulty and deficient compared with that of another law, than his own, he is troubled. Okay. So, whatever his swabhava is, he has to stick to that. He should not go to another swabhava, which can be very dangerous. When we discuss swabhava and swadharma, I will point out this to you. Okay. In chapter 2 and chapter 3, all these things are given. Mm-hmm. Now, Srimla is saying exactly, the nature, exclamation. But what is the sense of sin in the action with which he is preoccupied? Okay. What are you talking about the nature? I am talking about this sense of sin. But what of the sense of sin in the action with which he is preoccupied? Is it not? Okay, not the lower case. Is it not? It's not an upper case because this is Srimadu's style. Nobody else does it except Srimadu. Although it's two sentences, he is starting with the lower case because it's the same subject. Okay? Normally you would have put a semicolon or something, but he is starting another sentence after the question mark. Is it not this very nature which drives men as if by force and even against their better will to sin and guilt? Okay? Everybody is forced by their nature, and my nature is telling me not to act, not to kill people. So what is this? His practical intelligence is baffled by Krishna's assertion that it was he who, in ancient times, revealed to Vivasvan this yoga, since lost, which He is now again revealing to Arjuna. The secret of correct action in the physical world is to be found in the spiritual planes of consciousness. That is why I am telling you the spiritual plane of consciousness. And I have already revealed this. Now Sri Krishna is showing his eternal being. He is saying that long ago to Vivasvan, ancient times, I told this yoga. And now I am telling it to you again. I am just repeating. Problem that you are wanting to solve at the physical level cannot be solved at the physical level. You have to understand yoga. You have to go to a higher level of consciousness. Okay? And by his demand for an explanation, he provokes the famous and oft-quoted statement of Avatarbhava and its mundane purpose. Chapter 4. Okay?
Ranganathan, why mundane?
Mundane means in the physical world, when the avatar comes down, why does the avatar come down? Does he have a function in the physical world? That's what he's asking. No?
Mundane, by its meaning, is ordinary purpose, but the avatarhood's purpose is not ordinary, right?
No. You are not. Take it in the sense of worldly, like French word, okay. What you're saying is right. Mundane means ordinary, but ordinary belongs to the physical world. So here you have to take the mundane word as worldly, not ordinary. No? So, like month, no? The month is the physical world. So mundane, physical world, physical purpose. Every time that evolution has to go to another level, it is the avatar who does that work. This is what Srimad points out. The Rama established the moral code, okay? From an animal nature, he has gone to the moral code, mental level, morality. That's why the animals, the monkeys play such a large part in the Ramayana. Okay? From an animal level, you are going to a moral level. That's Rama did that one. So that itself indicates that Rama was definitely a historical character. Then you come to Sri Krishna. He established a spiritual principle, the overmind level of consciousness. And he also, therefore, Krishna also is an avatar. He also was a historical figure. Now, Sri Aurobindo is, if he has brought down the supermind, then by definition, he is an avatar. Because he has brought down the next level of consciousness. Every time there is a level which goes to another level, it's only the avatar who does that work. So, that's what he's pointing out. He is again...
Hello.
Yeah,
then
tell me.
What about Christ and Buddha? Were they avatars or they were not avatars?
Well, they were avatars, but their functions were... what I'm saying, going to another level of consciousness is not the only work that they do, na? It's not the only work. There are other works also to be done. So I'm not saying that every avatar has gone to another level. But when there is a level to be crossed, it is always done by an avatar. The reverse is not true. You follow what I'm saying? Yes. The going from one level to another level is done by an avatar. But every avatar does not do that. They have a physical action. For instance, Buddha, he solved the problem of suffering in the world. That was his purpose. Okay. If you ask me what was the purpose of Jesus Christ, I'll have to think about it. I'm not sure. Okay. I'll have to think about it. Or look up what Srimad has to say. He was definitely an avatar.
He brought morality to the Western world, right?
Yeah.
He had some ten Moses had said, and according to that, they have to live and not.
No, the Ten Commandments is...
Commandments, yes.
That's not Christianity. That Christianity uses, but it's not Christ. It is Moses.
Did Christ bring down love because he always spoke of love?
That's it. I think love, I think Sri Aurobindo has mentioned this also in Thoughts and Aphorisms or somewhere about love.
So the question of avatar hood also comes up. He is again perplexed by the words in which Krishna continues to reconcile action and renunciation of action, and asks once again, for a decisive statement of that which is the best and highest, not this mingled world. Vyavishrena. You are mixing words and confusing me. How can something psychological be physical? That's what he's asking. When he realizes fully the nature of the yoga, which he is bidden to embrace, his pragmatic nature, accustomed to act from the mental will and preference and desire, is appalled by its difficulty. And he asks, what is the end of the soul which attempts and fails, whether it does not lose both this life of human activity and thought and emotion which he has left behind, and the Brahmic consciousness to which it aspires, and falling from both, perish like a dissolving cloud. There is always a running connection between all the shlokas in all our texts. So here, very clearly, he is telling to rise to another level of consciousness, and he realizes, how can I do that? It's so difficult, I can't do. So suppose I fail, what will happen to me? Okay. So these are all the implied transitions. So he is asking, what happens if someone tries and fails? Then again he explains, okay, the Gita goes on to say that nothing is ever lost, it is gained. This is also a very interesting question. Every effort that you make adds something to you. Okay? It's never lost, it remains in the background, waiting to again become alive. I think that's what it is. What's the time? 8:31. So we are almost at the end of it. We got two more paragraphs to finish. So what shall we do? We have got 3 minutes left only. We can't finish, that is sure. We can finish it next time. Okay. But here, as I told you, there are a few questions which are very interesting. The basic question which is coming up here is, Arjuna is constantly asking for a solution in the physical world, but there is no such solution. I gave you one example of that. There are so many other examples. Is the collectivity more interesting, more true, or is the individual more, the individual rights are more important, or the collectivity more important? This is another question that simply cannot be solved at the mental level. China thinks the collectivity is more important. America thinks that the individual is more important. So these are the things that become even political questions. But you can't solve the problem. Impossible to solve the problem. So, then there are also so many other questions which are impossible to solve at the mental level. Okay. So, medicine particularly also throws out so many interesting questions. Like transplantation of organs. Is that right or wrong? The person is living. He's managing somehow to live. But are you doing some harm to him? Are the influences of that other man's heart coming into you? Does it create? What are the effects? All these questions come up, which cannot be solved so easily. At that same level, it cannot be solved. You have to go to the next level. That is one of the things implied in this one. Then also the question of avatar and the rebirth. All these questions are there. And he tells Arjuna, you don't remember your past lives, but I remember all my past lives. That is it. So, so many of you are there. I think many of you have read the Gita. Okay, but if any of you have not read the Gita, read it. Whether it be in Sanskrit or it be in an Indian language or even in English. Read it. It's a marvelous document. Okay.
Who was Vivasvan?
I will have to check, but is one of the earliest ancient times, obviously. It's not so important as to who he was, but I will have to check up. Okay, Vivasvan. If you want, I'll check that up and get back to you next time. I'll have to check on my... On the internet, we can check. Okay, Vivasvan, who was he? But many of these things are very symbolic. It certainly would not be a living historical character. That is sure. Vivasvan would certainly not be a historical character. It was symbolic that long ago, when the universe was created, yoga also was created at the same time. That's basically what it means. Okay, so we will take up this last two paragraphs next time. All right, so
merci beaucoup.
8:35. So, Guru Var, everybody.
Om Parangada, merci.
Okay. Guru Var.
Bonjour.